Hello, good morning. Thank you for inviting us. Well, we are the technicians of the KubeNet network. She's Cristina and my name is Felix. And today we are with Blas, Valero and Anna. And they are researchers here at the Institute of Pyrenaic Ecology, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And they are specialized in studying the pyroclimate with reconstructed records. Mm-hmm. Well, we are here because you are experts also in montane. I mean, we are at an institution that is specialized in the Pyrenees. So, as we are interested in montanes, we devote our time to study the central system. Mm-hmm. How would you define a mountain from your expertise, let's say, from your experience, your personal experience?
Oh, there are different. I think from an institute like this one, I most likely would be in terms of ecosystems. So there are very specific ecosystems that they are unique to mountains. So I think that would be one way to approach to answering that question. But from another point of view, you can define mountains are very unique reservoirs of many of the resources that we need to survive. So. And in that sense, I think for most people that we do not live in the mountains, we may think that it's something that's kind of a faraway place that you may go on vacation. But mountains are much more than that. We depend very heavily on mountains, even if we don't live there. We depend on them not just to go skiing or hiking during the summer. Here where we are, we drink what the mountains produce. And on the other side of the Pyrenees, it's the same. So it's really the importance of mountains in the resources that we consume as society is paramount.
Yeah,
and mountains are also very good sensors of climate change. In many changes in climate, the first place where we see them are in the mountains, because many ecosystems are close to the boundaries, to the limits, so they react very quickly to any change in temperature or in the amount of precipitation. So it's also part of our office in the mountains.
In GroomNet, we like to call them sentinels of climate change.
Yeah, sentinels of climate change.
Yeah, they're especially sensitive to climate conditions, so like climate change conditions. So
They're a little bit like islands that they are. Mm-hmm. Particularly here when we have sometimes fog in the valley.
They warn us about what is going to happen in the future.
Yeah, when you were talking about that we are here at the Pyrenean Institute of Ecology, and I think this is a good example of this view of the mountain as a very, from a very holistic point of view, because the reason that this institute was created in Jaca, it was to understand mountains from different point of view.
Yeah.
It wasn't an institute about ecology or about geography or about geology. It was an institute to understand what's going on in the mountains. And that means that you have to understand the biology, the flora, the fauna, all the physical processes, how people live there and what they need and how they have been living for the last centuries. So that and I think that is coming back now. There was one time in the history, maybe during the last century, that science was a little bit too divided into different small expertise. No? And I think we're going back to that idea that to really understand what's happening, you have to look at all the different aspects of living in the mountains. And climate is an example of that.
And humans are also in this big picture of the mountains. So we need to know all the impacts that we are doing in the mountains, and also the consequences for our lives there, and all there in this institute there is also a line of research about the land uses, the different land uses in the mountains, and the consequences of those. So. Mm-hmm.
And I think that's even now we always talk about climate change as being the main challenge that we have for the next century. And that is true, but climate change is only one of the big problems that we will face in the next century. There are other problems that are all kinds of compound within global change. So that's I think that's very significant to understand that it's not only the changes in climate that we will change the way we live, but also the changes in the biosphere, the changes in the biochemical cycles, the changes in habitats, all
the
of that.
The water resources that you said before.
Mm-hmm. All the feedbacks that we know and the ones that we don't know, how they're going to interact in the mountains. So.
Yeah. And all those processes interact a lot between them, so you need to understand everything together and to cooperate with other people working with different kinds of
the and we have to look at the past. That's what we do.
Since you are introducing a topic that we wanted to touch, that is the impact of climate change in mountains,
mm-hmm.
is it noticeable now in the 21st century how the climate change is impacting the Pyrenees?
Yes, it is. Yeah. In fact, in the Pyrenees, in general, in mountains, the increase in temperature is higher than the average in the world. So the ecosystems there are more impacted than in other areas, and there are impacts in the biodiversity, in the forests, in the line where the forest can live. And from the research that we do, for example, it's very very clear in the ecosystems that are related to the snow and to the ice. I work a little bit in glaciers and in caves where they have a ice deposits inside,
mm-hmm.
fossil ice that has survived for several millennia sometimes. And it's just recently that we can enter into those caves, because before that they were closed by ice. So in the last decades, this ice has melted, and so it's now that where we can go inside.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a new
new line of research,
but it's also the first time that this happens, no? Many
mm-hmm.
speleologists in the Pyrenees, they didn't know about those caves, and it's just now that they appear. And
mm-hmm.
so it's an evidence that something is changing in the last decades. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, all the studies of meteorological variables show clearly that the temperature is increasing in the Pyrenees. And then there is a little bit less of precipitation. Precipitation is not so clear, but it's also because most of the Pyrenees, particularly in the southern part, are within a Mediterranean type of climate, and variability in rainfall is one of the characteristics of this climate. So that's very clear. And also, you just need to go and talk to the elderly people that live
mm-hmm.
in the valleys, and they will tell you how different it was 50 years ago in terms of how much snow, the seasonality of the snow, all of
the
that.
The time of the crops, no?
The time of the crops.
Yeah, we're seeing the same in the central mountains of Spain. Yeah.
Those changes in seasonality are going to be very significant because, as we said before, we are drinking the water from the mountains for us and also for irrigation. And the amount of water that comes from the Pyrenees, it changes now because the time of the snow melt is also changing. So the time that we may need more water, it may not be the time that we
So
there's a decoupling of this too, I think. And of course, in terms of the amount of water, that's something else. The amount of the resources, but the distribution through the year is going to be
it's very important
different.
Also.
Mm-hmm.
Mostly in a Mediterranean climate. So,
mm-hmm.
And then I was saying something very interesting before, and is that when you go to the mountains, you find a lot of evidences of past and present climate changes, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you work mostly on speleothems and
mm-hmm.
Those kind of how you say archives.
Mm-hmm.
So you could tell us something.
The speleothems. Like, I have one here. Well, this is just half of a speleothem. It is how you see that in a cave, are carbonate formations. And they record in their composition the changes in climate that happened since it was formed. That is, in the base is the oldest part. And when we go to the top is the newest part, the more recent. This one covers, for example, 5 millennia. So it's the onset of the Holocene. The last interglacial period where we live. So studying the composition of the stalagmite, we know about past periods of climate change. And what is interesting for us is the evidences that we find about very rapid climate changes also in the past. And because we need, Blas was saying that we need this temporal context to understand the climate change. And now we know that the climate was not changing gradually in the past either, and there were very rapid climate changes. And with studying those rapid climate changes, we have evidences or we have analogs of what is happening today. So with stalagmites or with lake sediments, with other type of records, we can go deeply in time and see what was happening, what were the different processes.
And would you dare to say that the climate change we're living right now is kind of different somehow from past climate changes?
Yeah.
So is it noticeable the impacts of human activity?
Yeah. Well, with experiences probably are not the best archives to see that, because we need we don't have the uppermost part. We don't have the connection not very frequently, not very often, the connection between the instrumental period where we measure now the changes and the stalagmites. But for example, with glaciers, there is some clear evidence that the climate change today is very different, or is something exceptional in the last few millennia. We have obtained an ice core in one of the glaciers in the Pyrenees, in Monte Perdido Glacier. And the main objective with that study was to see if the glacier that is clearly disappearing today, is retreating very, very quickly. We wanted to know if during other warm periods in the last two millennia, if the glacier was still there or have disappeared. Mm-hmm. And we selected this last two millennia because it's the last, when we have the last natural climate changes like the Little Ice Age or the medieval climate anomaly, the medieval climate anomaly was a warm period, arid period and warm period in the Pyrenees, we know that. And what we have found studying the glacier is a clear evidence that the glacier was there during that warm period. Mm-hmm. It was a little bit smaller than in previous periods, but it was there, so it didn't disappear. And this gives us the context between today and the medieval climate anomaly. We can compare both periods, and we see that today it's totally different. Mm-hmm. The glacier is retreating much quickly, very rapidly, and it's the objective of our studies of the past.
What about the lacustrine sediments? Because in PLAS, your activities focus more on lake sediments and so on. Do they tell the same as the...
They tell a similar story. In the long, if you are talking about the last 10,000 years, there are many different changes, and some of them may be quite abrupt too, very rapid. But we are focusing now in the last 2,000 years, similarly to what they are trying to find in the glaciers. Mm-hmm. And if we look at the transitions in the lakes, in the ecology of the lakes during the last 2,000 years, the one that we see during the last 50 years is the most intense than the one we see during the last 2,000 years. And that is, of course, there is a very clear transition at the end of the Little Ice Age, particularly when we are talking about lakes that they're supposed to be pristine and they're over 2,000 meters now, because the glacier was a little bit closer and there is a change in climate conditions and physical processes. And we see that, you know, there's a big change from 1850 meters in the 19th century. But the next, starting from there, temperatures increase, there is a change in the biology of the ecosystem, but the big change starts about 1960. And that is clear in all the lakes that we're seeing. And we see an increase in bioproductivity, an increase in the accumulation of organic carbon. And that means two things. One is that the lakes are more productive, most likely because the temperature is a little bit higher during the early summer or the late summer. There are the two periods that we can have a higher productivity. And also maybe because there's another impact that is not only a climate impact, there is more nitrogen that is coming all over the place and actually is kind of a fertilizer for the lake. But this compound process of increasing temperatures and something completely new, which is that we are, even from here, we are fertilizing the lakes up in the mountains, it makes this particular time completely different of anything that has happened during the last 2,000 years. If we are seeing something like this in lakes that we consider that they are pristine, it's because this is affecting every single ecosystem.
Nothing yeah. is pristine anymore,
right? And I assume it's something you did both here in the extratropical latitudes and in South America, because you've worked much there in South America, also in Lake Titicaca.
It's
something you find also in the tropics, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, in the tropics, one link between glaciers and lakes is a stream there, because particularly when I work in South America and there, the retreat of the glacier is so fast that it creates lakes that they're 30 meters deep in 20 years.
Wow.
So the retreat is huge, and that creates many creates one problem of the regularity of the water supply, because if you have a glacier, then if here we drink from the mountains, in the Andes it's even more.
Yeah.
And if you have the glacier, it's kind of a stable water supply. If you don't have that, you don't know when you're going to have to have the water. But it also creates a risk of outburst or floods. So it's really significant.
We also have some new lakes now in the Pyrenees. They are not the same dimension.
Smaller scale,
but it's something that is really new in the last,
They were created from nothing, from the glaciers.
They were created from the glaciers, so they are next to the glaciers. And this is something that we plan to study, to see how a lake starts and how the sedimentation starts. And they can be also good records of what is happening now.
So I think these are little things, but I think we are seeing things, or we have seen things that our children will not. And that's something very unique in the history. Our parents maybe saw the same landscape of our grandparents, but our children will not. And I'm not putting a judgment value on that. But the significant part is that is what is happening. The time that we're living is so significant in the changes that in one generation things are going to be different. And most likely not as good.
And what can we do to preserve those landscapes, at least in mountain areas?
I think they're beyond preservation. I mean, the glaciers are going to disappear.
Yeah.
That's something
they are using blankets to cover the glaciers.
Really?
I don't know exactly the
Caucasus, I think.
Yeah, but it's true, the glaciers are going to disappear, and they will appear probably in some millennia later in the next glacier cycle, but now they are going to disappear,
I think in some areas we are beyond preservation. You know, we have to adapt to those new changes. You know, the landscapes are already different in the mountains, and they're all different because of the change in climate. They're also different because the change in population, the change in the economic activities, all of that has a huge impact.
Human impact.
So the two things together are the ones that they're really creating a new landscape. It's more about adaptation, not about preservation, because as Anna said, there are no pristine landscapes anywhere in Spain, in the mountains.
Yeah, it's
so from your point of view, which plants would you propose to adapt ourselves to this new climate change?
Well, thank you for the question.
I was just wanted to say that mitigation, I understand mitigation more in a global perspective, not thinking about only mitigation, climate change in mountains, but of course we can mitigate the climate change and there are many things that we can do as a society, and that will have consequences also in the mountains. But I understand this more in a global scale, not particularly located in the mountains.
There's almost every region, every autonomous region, they have an adaptation plan to global change, which is good, and at the same time it's like, well, we have to have a global, even for the Pyrenees, we need to have a strategy that is global beyond the Pyrenees, because climate change or biodiversity crisis is something it doesn't have any boundaries. Whatever we do, it has to be implemented at the local area, something that we do as citizens, but at the same time it has to be beyond the boundaries of ecosystems of countries. Mm-hmm. And those two, you know, they're very clear things that we have to do in the long term. We have to reduce the emissions. We have to reduce the use of natural resources. And that's something that we have to be able to really recycle more and more what we do, because it's not only about the climate change is going to make things worse, but not only because of climate change, it's going to be more difficult to have enough resources, it's going to be more, and climate change is going to make everything, the biodiversity crisis is going to get worse, but because of climate, but also because of what we do as
humans. Yeah, it affects the mountains, but everything in general, so So, do you think investigation is important when it comes to mountains and climate change in mountains?
Yeah, of course, we need the data of what's happening in the mountains now and what was happening in the past. We need to understand as much as possible how the climate change and what are the impacts in the mountains to take to the solutions. And to do that, we need observations in a long-term scale. We cannot use only the data that we have now. We need to have data for several years, and when looking into the past, we need to have many years into the past to understand the Pyrenees or the mountains in this holistic way that Blas was saying.
Yeah. We have to be able to convince people that we're living in a crisis, and that has to be done with science and also with emotions, that really people feel implicated in that. So the science is basic to that, because we have to be, I think the science is very clear what is happening, but we have to communicate that maybe a little better so people feel implicated in that. And the situation with the pandemic, I think, is an example of that. The only way that we can really move ahead and have a vaccination in a record time is if we feel that we are really in a crisis.
And we invest money.
All the things that they were impossible to do before the pandemic, in terms of collaboration, in terms of using that, all of a sudden it was possible. I think that's exactly what we need in terms of solving the climate crisis and the environmental crisis, that sense of urgency. Things, they need to be done now. And I don't think that's being pessimistic. I think it's exactly the opposite. We face the problem because we are optimistic that we are able to tackle it more than, we don't know, things will happen and eventually we will survive after this.
It's
the other way around.
And I think that we need everyone to do that. We need that everyone takes actions against climate change. And to get involved, you need to believe that something is happening, and for that you need the science to the data and the evidence.
Yeah, the evidence, I think they're very clear about what, I think we need convince people that you just look at the evidence and then you make a decision about what would be the best to do in the future. But it's difficult for all of us to think of changing something now, because we're going in the wrong direction. The way we live, we had to change it a little bit. That is the difficult part to communicate.
The problem that I see is that, for example, science doesn't render immediate responses. Mm-hmm. I mean, people think that when a problem comes up, you just use investigation and within a month you have a response.
Yeah.
That's not the...
And then the answer is clear. No, we know this, and this is the range of uncertainty. And we had to live with that.
I think society has to understand that you have to invest money to build a proper structure that then you can use when it's needed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that it's, results are not immediate.
Yeah, that's
long-term.
It's primary to invest in this kind of networks, I think, in this kind of research institutes, because in the end, you will find the responses. If you don't have the media, you will never.
And also kind of the warning signals that something is going wrong with the glaciers are disappearing. Well, the glaciers in the Pyrenees are very small. The lakes are changing, but they're also quite small. But they're telling us that something really big is changing. Mm-hmm. And the only way to know that is through this very detailed investigation.
And the consequences will be for
everyone. Since mountains are giving us all these warnings about what is going to happen to the rest of the world, to what extent do you think it's important to establish mountain observation networks?
That's really very important, only with this network we'll be able to have all the data that we need, and it's also important to compare different mountains, so to have several similar strategies in the different systems and the different mountain systems that we have to compare to, and yeah, to see what is happening. Different type of data for us. Mm-hmm. For example, the number of days that a lake is covered by ice is an important parameter for the lake. And also in the glacier, for example, we monitor people in this institute. They monitor every year the retreat of the glacier, the amount of water that it's produced, the consequences in the region. Mm-hmm. So all this is important to maintain, to have these mm-hmm. warnings.
Because every mountain, it's different from an ecosystem point of view, but also from a political administration point of view.
Yeah.
And learning how to create those networks of mountains in mountains that they are within one country, within different countries, mm-hmm. how to share all the data, how to create organizations that they go just beyond the, you know, a local entity.
Yeah.
I think that we can learn a lot.
It's a good example for that because yes. Both countries, Spain and France and Andorra, are involved with them. Yeah.
And those networks have to be something stable in time. There are so very few examples of networks that survive one decade.
Would you say investment on mountain networks is underestimated or underrated?
Oh, very much.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think there's one problem, which is just every country, they usually have observing and taking numbers, taking observations, doing field work is not usually in the forefront of what the international agencies want to fund. So the funding goes to a different type of research, not maintain an observation that maybe is not going to produce a scientific paper in 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
But that, well, we're saying that, for example, something so simple as the pictures that were taken in the landscape of the Pyrenees in the 1950s in the Pyrenees Institute of Ecology, when people would go with the small
camera
and take pictures. Now, those are unique because it's the only way that we know how the landscape was in 1950s.
Yeah.
So if in the 1950s we would have started something like this, now we really would be able to understand what's going on change and climate change. We didn't do that. So it's, and that is so difficult for politicians to understand.
Yeah.
Because you have to create something that is going to continue taking data for the next generations.
Mm-hmm.
And it has to be funded, and the data
will
be there.
Because
most of the observations
are actually maintained
by 3 or 4 year projects, and that's not the way to do it.
Okay, so thank you very much for your time. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you very much for talking to us, for having us here. It was a nice chat.
Well, very nice.
Thank you so much for being available.
Next time, Sierra de Guadarrama.
Okay,
okay,
next time we'll go there.
Thank you.